Comrade advisors, here is my advice. We must get into people's homes without hidden microphones or secret police. The President of the United States has a record that people buy and take into their homes. I'll try to find out how he does this. Operator, get me quick United States. Number is White House, White House, White House. That's V, V. Like in Wonderful. Hello, hello? Now, little girl, let me speak to Papa. Never mind who this is, little girl. I want to talk with your Papa. I don't care if he's on his rocker or off his rocker. I still want to talk with your Papa. All right. This is Premier, this is Uncle Nick. Uncle Nick. No, no, the one with the, not the one with the bag and the reindeer. That's Saint Nick. I'm the one who brought you the dog. No, I don't want to talk with the dog. No, I don't. All right. Bow wow. Okay. I'm happy to hear dog is fine. What's that? He brings in the newspaper every morning. Good. What? All except the Herald Tribune? I see. Now, darling, will you please call your papa? Put on the phone and go call him. No, don't hang up the phone. Just put it down. Don't hang. Hello, hello, hello. I can't believe it. Operator, operator, would you ring that same exact number you did before? But this time, with no mistakes. And don't charge me for the first call. That was the wrong number. Oh, those operators. Hello. This is the White House. Which Kennedy do you wish to speak to? This is the President. Yes, it is. I am aware that I don't sound exactly like I do on the record. And that is probably because I did not make the record. I wish I did. Someone else did. But we are thinking of covering it. Well, that means making a record ourselves. Even if it's too late to be a smash with the public, we figure that if we can just sell it to the immediate family alone, we will have to come out with a profit. What's that, Chairman Khrushchev? You called to find out what? I see. Well, I would suggest that you should first have an open press conferences as we do. Then let your public know about you and your family. Yes, invite them into your home. As Jackie did on television over here. Yes, yes. You seem to have grasped the entire idea with great vigor. And finally, I would suggest that you take up some Russian game that you can play with your entire family. Like perhaps touch soccer or weightlifting or something like that. Oh, yes, you're welcome. Any time at all.
Wonderful. Comrades, we have learned the secrets of all they have done. Now let us do it first.
This is Radio Moscow, located on all mega cycles all over the radio band. See the Ukraine from our cattle train. I'll tell you, that's the only way we have to go. Yes, comrades, if you want to go, or if you need to go, or let's face it, when you're forced to go, the thing to do is to let Hirsch put you in the cattle car. And now Radio Moscow present a program of special interest.
Here are instructions on how to use the new Western-type democratic, automatic voting machines that will be employed in the forthcoming free elections. When you enter the beautiful glass enclosed, airtight, soundproof, completely private voting booth, you will see two levers. If you want to vote for the candidate of the Soviet Party, you will pull the left lever, and then you will hear the machine automatically register your vote. If you do not wish to vote for the Soviet Party candidate, you will pull the right lever, and then you will hear the machine automatically drop a small pellet into a pan of sulfuric acid beneath your chair. Then, within a few moments, you will definitely join the party of your choice. Are you the shoemaker or the apprentice?
Oh, I am the shoemaker himself, sir.
Do you know who I am?
Oh, yes, everyone knows you, sir.
Well, I want you to fix this pair of shoes for me.
Oh, yes, sir. Immediately. What seems to be the trouble?
The trouble is in the heels.
They're worn down?
Yes, and I like them thick. So I want you should put 3 heels on each shoe.
3 heels on each shoe?
Yes.
But, sir, that would build up your back too high. And then, even if you would be standing up, you'll be so far forward that you'll be laying down.
Don't argue with me. Put on the heels.
Yes, sir, at once. There you are, sir. All finished.
Good. I needed this right away because I have an international conference to attend tomorrow.
I'm honored to have been of service. Would you like to try them on now?
I will not try them on. I will try them out.
Good evening, everybody. Tonight, we will be making history. For together, we are going on the first open tour of the Red House in the Kremlin. And our guide will be none other than Mrs. Khrushchev herself. Our television cameras and crew are all set up here in Red Square, ready to bring you this historic telecast via the miracle of Telstar. And as we enter the gates of the Kremlin and approach the Red House, I think I see Mrs. Khrushchev there awaiting us. Hello there, Mrs. Khrushchev.
How are you, Ed?
Fine, thank you. And how is your family, Mrs. Khrushchev?
We are fine, so far. And Ed, you may call me Mrs. Khrushchev.
Thank you, Mrs. Khrushchev.
That's much better. You see, we want this tour to be very informal.
I see. My, that is a lovely house dress you are wearing.
Oh, thank you, Ed.
I especially love the print and the apron.
Yes, thank you. This dress was designed for me by one of your own top designers. I just received his latest complete brochure. Perhaps you are familiar with his work.
What is his name?
C.S. Roebuck. I used to use Montgomery Ward, but his styles have become very bourgeois. We prefer simple things in Russia. You know, very informal.
Of course. And those lovely shoes are certainly very becoming. What do you call that style?
Those are called brown Oxfords, with laces and with ripple soles and heels. I used to wear them with the Cuban heels, but there have been certain policy changes.
I understand, of course.
Anyway, I was very glad you liked these shoes because originally I was going to wear my army shoes. As I said before, I wanted to be very informal.
Yes, that certainly was a wise move.
Now then, shall we proceed into the house?
Yes, I'll call the cameraman and
crew.
No
cameras.
But we came.
And there'll be no cameras allowed.
But we came all the way from.
No, there'll be no cameras allowed.
But the people in America.
Even Alan Funt, he didn't get in, and he told us he was Eisenhower.
We were like.
Ed, you're lucky you're getting in.
I want to tell
Ed,
you that.
I'm lucky I'm getting in.
But the men.
Ed, let's proceed. We must start at once if we want to see it all. It's a very big place.
Yes, it certainly is.
A person could easily get lost in here. Permanently.
I understand.
Now we walk to the main hall through these doors.
This is a lovely main hall.
Yes. Yes, it was a gift. A gift that we took from the Soviet people. And we see across the hall there what we are calling the Alexander Nevsky dining room. That is the door over there.
You are showing us the dining room door? Well, it certainly is a lovely door.
Thank you. And that door was a gift that we confiscated from Count Alexander Nevsky during the revolution of 1917.
That's very nice. Really a beautiful door.
Now you see the rug in front of the door?
Lovely.
The pattern of it is the crest of the Rosky family and is a gift that we appropriated from the state of Count Leonid Larovsky just before his sudden illness in 1917.
Uh-huh.
And that chair there in front of the door?
Yes, I see it.
It's a very nice chair, don't you think?
A beautiful chair.
It's an old antique and of considerable historic value. And that chair was donated to the Kremlin by Count Yuri Faya just before he left the country because of illness. The secret police, it seems, found out about his illness about 6 hours too late.
Well, that's too bad.
But the chair stands there anyway. The main feature in front of the door to this room is that table over there.
Yes, a lovely carved table.
That we call the Alexander Nevsky table. And we are all very, very fond of it.
Yes, and who is that bearded gentleman seated over there behind the table?
That man was Alexander Nevsky. He was very, very fond of the table, too.
That's right, mm-hmm.
Shall we proceed down the hall?
Yes, of course.
Now, if you'll notice over there on your right and my left.
Yes.
That is the door to the music room, which we are calling the Shostakovich music room.
Yes.
I haven't got the key. Now, on your right and my left.
Pardon me, Mrs. Khrushchev. Don't you mean on my left and your right?
Ed, I am always on the left.
Oh, I see.
Barry Goldwater is the one who is always on the right.
Yes, of course.
Anyway, on your right and my left, you can see the door to the Dostoevsky reading room. I do not have the key.
I see. And that door over there, what room is that?
That is the door to the Lenin closet.
And you don't have the key.
No, I'm very sorry. Now, over here is an interesting room.
Yes, and I notice it has no door at all.
No, none at all. Be careful, Ed. Watch out for the wind. Watch out, the wind will knock you down, and watch where you step.
Well, it's rather hard to see with all the snow falling. But it appears to me that this room has no ceiling. No floor and no walls.
Yes, that is completely correct. Ed, please move. Please move away. I'm afraid you'll catch a cold without a coat on.
That was a very interesting room. What is it called?
The room used to be the Stalin room, but as you've seen, we had it removed.
Pardon me. I'm looking for the John Adams conference room. I just came out of the Lucy Monroe foyer room. I passed through the Dolly Madison cupcake room. Then went into the Nelson Rockefeller waiting room. And I can't seem to find my way through here.
That man is so lost. He doesn't even know he's on the wrong record. Now, here is one of our public rooms. It is the Russian steam room. I don't think that it's in use, so please open the door for me. Will you, Ed?
Certainly.
It's a lot of steam, isn't it? We Russians like a lot of steam.
Yes, it's as thick as pea soup. Oh, my comrade, oh, my comrade, oh, my comrade, my encounter. You are lost in God forever, and I hope I won't be next.
Close the door, Ed.
Well, wasn't that your husband?
Well, I'm not sure. It was very steamy, but I think so. Yes, it probably was.
He certainly likes to sing.
Yes. He loves to talk and sing and laugh, and I hope that the secret police will leave him exactly as he is. Anyway, Ed, thanks for coming.
But, Mrs. Khrushchev, we haven't actually been in any of the rooms yet.
I'm so sorry, but I don't have the keys.
But I wonder if...
It's difficult to go in the rooms if you don't have the keys.
Yes, that is a problem.
But it is no longer our problem.
What do you mean?
Our problem now is no longer getting in the rooms. I think our problem now is getting out.
Good night and good luck.
I welcome you, members of the press, to our first open press conference. I will try to answer all of your questions, so you will just raise your hands. I will recognize you.
Chairman Khrushchev.
Yes, stand and identify yourself.
Nikolai Nikolov, the People's Press.
Your question.
Years ago, we all had very little trouble with Western Germany. But recently, we have had a lot of trouble with the Western Germany. Why is this?
Well, because for a long while, we thought that their leader's name was Comrade Adenauer. Next question.
Mr. Khrushchev, Mr. Chairman.
Stand, please.
Sergei Novikov from Pravda.
Your question.
According to the latest 5-year plan which you introduced 18 years ago. By now, the Soviet people was supposed to have cars, refrigerators, toasters, and deep freezers. My question is, when do we get there?
You get it now. Guards, take this man out and give it to him. Next question.
It's Chairman Khrushchev.
Stand and identify yourself.
Anton Antonovsky, People's Press. The question is, the U.S. has created a place which they call Disneyland. Now, why can't we also have a Disneyland?
What is Disneyland? Unbelievable. Bizarre, beyond the wildest imaginations, incredible. We have always had such a place. Siberia. The only trouble is attendance has fallen off. Next question.
Mr. Chairman,
Stand up and identify yourself.
I am standing up.
Why can't I see you?
I don't know. I'm standing. In fact, I'm standing on top of my brother. And he is standing. Hold me up a little higher, Michel.
I beg your pardon. All right. Identify yourself.
I'm Gregory Grigorievich, the Short People's Press.
What is your question?
My question is that we have heard about the United States U-2 missions. Now, what do we do to obtain their secrets?
Well, we never need to employ such underhanded and sneaky methods of obtaining information as to resort to such things as U-2 planes. Whenever we want the plans and designs of one of their ships or missiles or spacecraft, we simply have one of our UN delegates go to Macy's toy department and purchase Hobby Kit. Next question.
My name is Comrade Desi Duzi, the Habana de la Revolucion.
Your question, please.
My question, please.
That is what I said.
My question is, we have in Cuba just heard that the Russian comrades were the one who first created the Bossa Nova.
That is correct. Of course, we did not call it the Bossa Nova. We call it the Bosnik Novakov. And it, like most other dances, was created by famous Russian dance teachers, Arthur and Katrina Morievich.
Very well. My question is this. Then, when are you coming to Cuba so that we can teach you how to create the rumba, the mambo, the cha-cha, and other dances?
Comrade, may I remind you that our two countries have recently learned a new dance simultaneously. It was called the sidestep. Next question, please.
Peter Petrovich Tass, Chairman Khrushchev. We all know of the NATO alliances and other mutual assistance treaties formed by the Western countries. What have we Soviet peoples done along these lines?
The Soviet nations was among the first nations in the world to pledge mutual assistance to one another should one or all of them be involved in armed conflict or the threat of armed aggression. Just recently, during the crisis in Cuba, our good friends of Red China sent us columns and columns of troops and told us we could take our choice of two from column A, one from column B, one from column A, or two from column C. Next question.
Leon Lermanitsky is Vestia.
Yes, and what is your question?
We have heard that the West believe the Soviet government is brainwashing the people. Do we do this?
Absolutely not. It is a lie. It is another example of the vicious falsehoods and baseless propaganda started by the capitalist totalitarian monsters of the world. We do not brainwash, understand? We do not brainwash. Repeat after me. We do not brainwash.
We do not brainwash.
We never brainwash.
We will not brainwash.
We will not brainwash. Your eyes are getting heavy.
My eyes are getting heavy.
Your eyes are getting very heavy.
My eyes are getting very heavy.
You are going to sleep.
I'm going to sleep.
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 Guards, remove the man. He is sleeping during the conference. You know the penalty for that. Now, that will be all. Wait a second. We have one more question, if I can find it. We have one more question here.
Yeah, Sasha Novikov. You spoke to my brother before about the deep freezers.
Oh, yes. What is your question?
Yeah, where did you bury my brother?
Thank you, Mr. Jim. Thank you. Wonderful, wonderful. Next on our show, we have a wonderful surprise. Comrade Milkov, the head of our secret police, has graciously consented to be on our little show here.
Enough talk. Comrades, I will now do for you some vocal impressions, impersonations, and imitations of famous stars. After I complete each voice, you will all clap. You will cheer, you will applaud, and you will love it. First impression, James Kognovich. All right, comrades, you gave it to my brother in the bag, which is pretty normal for this country. Enough. Next impression, scene from big hit television program, Dr. Zhivago. Now, see here, Dr. Zhivago. You can't be going around with this nurse and that nurse and this nurse, because we only have male nurses. Did you love it? Next impression, from current big hit movie, Sweeping Country, The Sheik, I will do Rudolf Valentinovsky. I will do this voice. That's all. I thought I really captured the quality. And now, comrades, I'm finished. All that. When I say something like that, you don't have to applaud that loud.
Wonderful, wonderful. All right, all right. And remember the numbers to call. In Moscow, it's Sputnik 123, blast off. In the Crimea, the number is Blackbread 6792. In Cuba, the number is, that number has been canceled. In Siberia, the telephone number is...
Comrade.
Yes?
There are no telephones in Siberia.
Wonderful, wonderful. You folks in Siberia, just keep those carrier pigeons flying.
Comrade, they can't even hear you. They don't got no radios, neither.
Wonderful, wonderful. All right, boys, one and two and three.
Yes, Mrs. Khrushchev, will there be anything more?
Well, I think we would like to have another dozen TV sets.
1 dozen TV sets.
Make 6 of them the kind you look at, and 6 of them the kind that look at you. We want to put them in the guest rooms.
I understand. And what else?
Let me see. We want 8 air conditioners, 4 electric dishwashers, 3 power mowers for the Kremlin lawn.
Yes, madam.
And 7 electric washers, 4 electric dryers, 2 electric stoves, and a complete set of electric cookers in all sizes.
And anything else?
Yes, and a prune Danish.
Of course, madam. Will that be all?
I think that will be all for now. When will these things be delivered?
Let me see. According to latest Soviet progress reports, in about 20 to 30 years.
Nina, may I have the copy of Pravda?
But darling, I am doing the puzzle.
What is the puzzle this week?
The same one as always. What happened to Molotov?
Yes.
Nikita, why can't we have another party?
I told you why. We cannot have another party because in this country there is only one party.
I would think that since you are the boss, we could change that.
If I change that, I would no longer be the boss. So, no party, understand?
Very well. Why don't we go and see a movie?
Maybe you have the paper. Look it up and see what's playing.
Let me see. The Pushkin Theater is showing How to Run a Wheat Harvester. And the Mendeleev has a double feature. Wide Potato Crop Failed, playing with Who Pulled the Vodka in the Volga.
Nah, I don't like mysteries.
We could go to the stadium and watch the chess matches.
No, 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 it makes you too excited. Remember what you did last time we went.
Well, what about we go to the Black Sea for the weekend?
No, the weather report said that the blizzards and the snowdrifts will continue down there all week.
My, they're certainly having poor weather there this season.
Yes, all of the resort owners are complaining. They say this is the worst summer they ever had.
Yes, but they say that every year.
Yes, they do.
How about we call up Mikoyan? He's always got people over his house. Maybe he'll invite us over.
I sent Mikoyan to Cuba.
What about calling up Malenkov? He's always...
You forgot I sent him somewhere else. Years ago.
Yes, that's right. What about Mao Zedong?
No, it's too much trouble calling him up because 20 minutes later you have to call him up again.
What about Zhukov?
Zhukov is very busy. Remember I told you that he was assigned to produce big propaganda picture about how we Soviet people invented the telephone?
Yes.
Well, the entire production schedule has gone behind because Don Amici refuses to be in the film.
So, what you going to do?
What else? They are busy inventing Don Amici.
All right, Mickey. How about sending out for a pizza?
That would probably be cold by the time we got it, because the nearest place you can get one is Israel. Besides, today is Saturday and Israel is closed.
So, what will we do tonight?
We will do what we always do. We will sit here and wonder what to do. Hand me that copy of Pravda.
I told you. I'm trying to figure out the puzzle. Maybe you want to help me to do it.
No, I have to disqualify myself from doing that puzzle. It would be poor sportsmanship if I helped you with it. You see, I know what happened to Molotov. Every old acquaintance must be forgot is our philosophy. So many names have been erased. I hope the next one is not me.
Yes, communism's lots of fun, 'cause there's so much to do. You never know who's thinking what.
Or who is watching who.
And next week on our show, we have more acts that we brought back from our recent tour of Russia.
Now, Natasha, you have already had 4 glasses of tea with lemon. So go to sleep.
But, Grandpa, tell me a bedtime story.
Natasha, it is very late. You must...
But, Grandpa, please tell me a story.
Very well, Natasha. Once upon a time, there were 3 bears. One was a short, stout, balding bear, but a bear of the people, from very good peasant stock. Virile, competent, clever, and I might say, thoroughly charming. The second was a small, noisy, bearded bear who smoked cigars and never changed his clothes. And the third was a tall, wealthy, capitalist bear with a lot of hair on his head and a very thick accent.
Now it seems that the balding bear and the bearded bear got together to help the bearded bear with his country, which was having a bit of minor difficulties. So the balding bear sent the bearded bear's country some agricultural and industrial equipment, and also a couple thousand technicians to assemble, load, and aim this agricultural industrial. Now, for some reason, the tall, wealthy, capitalistic bear and his followers got very disturbed about the situation and wanted to start a fight over this. They even put up a bunch of bear traps all around the land of the bearded bear. How foolish. Because the bear, the balding bear, and the crazy ball bearings. Because the balding bear did not want to fight. His record shows he has always been for peace. A piece of Hungary, a piece of Poland, and so forth. Besides, the balding bear knew full well that his philosophy is the only correct ones. He knew that the reforms, techniques, and methods of this philosophy will triumph over any other. And the working class of the world are long oppressed, and threw off their chains, because they have nothing to lose but their slavery. And together, under the red banner, they took...
Grandpa, stop shouting and banging your house slippers. You'll wake everyone in the house.
Yes, excuse me. Now, go to sleep in pleasant dreams, Natasha.
Good night, Grandpa.
Yes, my dear. Good night.
You know what kills me? He really believes all that jazz.